Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron here today. I want to answer a question about what happens at death when we die. You know, there's fascinating studies that have been done as far as does the body actually lose microscopically some type of weight when someone dies. You'll read about those studies. Another one is showing that the brain still functions for anywhere from a few seconds to 20 minutes after death. But that's not what I'm talking about here today. This is a scriptural look, a biblical look at what happens when people die. Now, the first thing we have to know is that mankind, we are made up of body, soul, and spirit. So even though these three are one, so to speak, certain things happen when we die. Of course, at death, the body ceases to function. Now, there is a certain thing to where it talks about the Christian sleeps. But then in another time, such as Luke 16, which is not a parable, by the way, a person is never named in a parable, but it is an actual event, you have the rich man and Lazarus. And really, for New Testament perspectives, that seems to be where we should look for what happens at death. For the rich man was in a place of paradise, Abraham's bosom, and a large part of that was taken captive into heaven, according to Ephesians chapter 4, when Jesus rose from the dead. Remember, it said many in Matthew 27, that many walked in the holy city, or Matthew 26, excuse me, that Old Testament saints walked around the city and were known of many. And so, to be absent from the body, Paul said, is to be present with the Lord. So to the Christian, this is our blessed hope. Now, you might say, if I'm already in the presence of the Lord, then why is there a resurrection necessary? Because again, that is just your spirit that is in the presence of the Lord. And so now if you're wicked, what happens then is just like the rich man opens his eyes in hell, and you are in hell. And both the wicked and the righteous, the wicked and the holy, are awaiting judgment. And there will be a day called the first resurrection that everyone that partakes of the first resurrection will be in the presence of God forever. Now, the first resurrection seems to have many different parts to it. Jesus, the first fruits of them which slept, then those that were taken with Jesus Christ that walked around the city of Jerusalem according to Matthew chapter 26, and then the catching away, the parousia, the coming of the Lord for His church, then that will be a part of the resurrection as well. It seems like there will be a catching away of Jewish believers in the midpoint of the tribulation, according to Revelation chapter 14. And then those that are beheaded for the Word of God, that have experienced the gospel of Jesus Christ, they will be resurrected before the millennia, and they will rule and reign with Jesus Christ. And then there's what's known as the second resurrection. And during the course of this second resurrection, it is the resurrection of the wicked dead. And what happens at this resurrection, at either resurrection, is our body, soul, and spirit are reunited to stand before God in judgment. Now you might say, what about cremation? What about those that have their ashes scattered around the world? What about organ transplants? What about, you know, those, somebody gets a heart or a liver, spleen or kidney from someone else, an eye transplant? Well, God is able to straighten all those things out. If God can create everything that is supernatural, then certainly He can resurrect supernaturally. And so everyone who is partakers of the first resurrection is saved. It's, the Bible's very clear on this. It says, blessed and holy are those that are partakers of the first resurrection. Over such, the second death hath no hold, or no overage in a certain way to say that. But in the second resurrection, everybody is going to stand at the great white throne judgment. Now, we're all going to stand at the judgment seat of Christ. There's going to be the believers that are resurrected before this. We are going to get rewards and crowns. We're going to be saved. The Bible is very clear that there's different levels of rewards in heaven and different levels of punishment in hell. It talks about you know, five different crowns in the New Testament, a shepherd's crown, soul winner's crown, this type thing. It says, too much is given, much is required. Luke chapter 12, verses 47 and 48. To those that didn't know and didn't do it, they shall be punished with few stripes. Those that knew and rejected, they shall be punished with many stripes. And so it says some people are going to be saved as it was by fire, that their works are going to be burned up, but they're still going to be saved. It's like they did works, but it was out of the will of God, but they still loved Jesus. They still had the gospel of Jesus Christ applied to their life, and they were following what Scripture says, but not the specific purpose and plan of God for their life. So their works are going to be burnt, as it were, with fire, wood, hay, and stubble. Others are building with gold, silver, and precious stones. So they're at the second resurrection, the second, a lot of seconds, there's going to be the second death. There's going to be the lake of fire. And everyone is going to stand before God. And at this resurrection. Now, people ask, what type of body are we going to be resurrected with? Well, 1 Corinthians 15 is known as the resurrection chapter. And it likens it to bare grain. You plant a seed in the ground, and up comes that seed's very small, very hard kerneled, all this. And all of a sudden, out comes this thing of beauty that's able to, you know, feed a multitude and all of this type thing. So is the resurrection of the dead. It's sown in dishonor. It's raised in honor. So, and the Bible's very clear. There is an earthly body. There is a spiritual body. So we're going to be raised, kingdom of God. Flesh and blood doth not inherit the kingdom of God. We're going to be raised with a new body. And in the first resurrection, that new body is never going to be able to hurt, never going to be able to feel pain anymore. Former things are passed away. And so, again, quoting what Paul said, to be absent from the body is present with the Lord. In the second resurrection, you're going to stand at the great white throne judgment. The books are going to be opened, and then the book of life. And everyone, you're going to be judged out of what's in these books. Well, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, even those who are born during the millennial reign, unless they come to Jesus Christ, to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so then, obviously, you're going to be judged out of that, and then your name's not going to be in the book of life of the Lamb from the foundation of the world, and you're going to be cast in a lake of fire. So if you are wicked, the judgment of the wicked dead begins when you die. You are, in a very real sense, tormented in your soul and your spirit in hell. And you are awaiting a final judgment where hell and death are cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. And the flame of their torment will go up forever and ever. And you're going to be there with the devil and his angels. It was never intended for you. Jesus shed enough blood for everybody on earth. He wants you to be blessed. He wants you to be like Adam and Eve, you know, in the garden, so to speak, in that sense that it was the garden of delights, garden of pleasure. He wants you to live with him for eternity. And so at the second resurrection, the great white throne judgment, at the first resurrection is the judgment seat of Christ, God. Romans chapter 14, verses 10 and 11. So at death, our spirit and soul go to a place where we are awaiting eternal judgment. If you're righteous, come living for Jesus, it's going to go to a place of God, place of paradise. If you are wicked, it's going to go to a place of torment, awaiting a resurrection. Everyone will be raised from the dead. Everyone will stand at the judgment seat of Christ. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. The key is are you going to confess and bow your knee now when it makes an eternal difference? Are you going to do it then when you should have done it on this side of eternity? It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, to judgment. Do it right now. That's my imploring to you in the name of Jesus, because God loves you. He shed his blood in the form of his son for you. He wants you to go to heaven. He raised his own body from the dead, raised that temple after 3 days, the temple of his body. He has done it for you. You can be saved. So again, this is what happens at death. Our body dies, goes into the ground. Our spirit and our soul goes to the places awaiting judgment. And during the waiting period of that judgment, it's in either eternal bliss, to be absent from the body, present with the Lord, or it's an eternal torment. And then when your body comes back together, then that's where you're going to be through all eternity. And hellfire, suffering all the pains and horrible things. You might say, why would a just God do that? Why wouldn't a just God do that when He created everything for good, for pleasure, for love? He's given us the gospel, so to speak, in the skies, Psalm 8. Their line goes throughout all the earth. He does everything possible. He makes a God-sized hole. He's the light that lighteth every man that cometh in the world. If He be lifted up, He's drawing all men unto Him. He's doing it, though God be not far from every one of us. We reject Him. We reject His love. He rejects us through all eternity. All hell is, basically, is a fulfilling of the unrighteous's desire. I don't want God. He's like, okay, then you don't have me throughout all eternity, and there will be eternal punishment. There's only two places. There's no purgatory. So that's what happens to the dead. God bless you. Make right choices, eternal choices in your life, in Jesus' name. Amen.